Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to Step Up, the show for the young Muslimah. I'm Khadija.
And I'm Salma, and in this series, we aim to discuss issues that affect us as young Muslimahs.
And we look to Islam to find comprehensive and practical solutions to show how Islam is applicable for us as young people in the 21st century.
So, what's on the show today?
Well, we start off with Ask Big Sister, where Sister Hanaa will be on the hotspot answering our questions about halal ways to socialise. With restrictions in places we can go and relax, what are things to consider when deciding to go out with friends?
In our standout segment, we visit the Guide Dogs for the Blind Association and find out how these fascinating creatures are trained to help the blind.
And after that, we'll be learning more about Arqam bin Abi Akram, one of the companions of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
We then go to our upcoming talent segment and speak to Sister Mona Ali, who has a passion for photography. So, lots coming up in the next hour. Don't go anywhere. Today's on Ask Big Sister, we talk about having halal fun. You might be wondering what that is exactly or whether it even exists. I'm Sara, and joining me in this discussion, I have my awesome sisters, Khadija, who's 17 and currently doing her A-levels.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. We then have Anisha, who's 15 and doing her GCSEs.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. And lastly, but by no means least, we have Hanaa, who's 14 and also doing her GCSEs.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. So sisters, a question I have for you today is, what's the number one thing that you find yourself doing in your free time?
Okay, well, I read books like all the time, 24/7. Love reading. So yeah, mine would definitely probably be reading books. Like, yeah, just doing that to pass my free time. So I think once I get absorbed in a good book, that's it. I'm out for like a whole day my room, yeah. Just reading.
But, fantastic. Yeah. What about you, Anisha?
Hands down, it has to be sleeping for me, because either I'm so busy, I literally don't have any free time. So when I do, I'm just like, I have to take a snooze.
That's literally me. I wish I could give like a really cultural, cool answer, but me, I'm just eating all the time. I love different cafes, restaurants, cultures, recipes. I love it. I like visiting museums as well. Maybe that's not as cool, but
I love museums, yeah. And art galleries as well. Yeah, really awesome. Yeah, it's great to really appreciate the art. For me personally, it has to be hanging out with my brothers and sisters. I'm one of six children at home. Mashallah. So alhamdulillah, it's like a party every day at our place. Because of course, as Muslims, our purpose in life is to worship Allah, but that doesn't at all mean we seclude ourselves from everyone else when doing so. Our faith encourages us to really engage with people, both on a personal level and a communal level, and to do so in a positive and productive way. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did various things to maintain their relationship, which, believe it or not, did include having halal fun. But if there are restrictions, what are they? And what kind of things can we do to have an awesome time together and rekindle those bonds of sisterhood? To help us answer these questions, we have with us Sister Hanaa, who's on the Ask Big Sister hot seat today. Sister Hanaa, would love for you to join us.
Assalamu alaikum, sisters.
Hi.
How are you guys today?
Good,
alhamdulillah. How are you?
Alhamdulillah. Yeah,
it's great to have
good.
You on the show, yeah. Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah.
Could you tell us a bit about yourself?
Well, yes, I'm a student. I'm studying economics at the moment. And yeah, alhamdulillah, I've been a young person, obviously, and I still do a lot of work with young people. So alhamdulillah, it's really good to be here today.
Okay, now I have a question for you. So what was the last place you travelled?
To be honest, I always thought I liked travelling, but then to be honest, this summer, alhamdulillah, I've had opportunity to go to lots of places and I'm finding it quite tiring now. I'm sort of person just to be at home. I may not be the most travelling person, I think, when I grow up. Well, I am grown up, but I think, well, the last place anyway that I travelled to was Dubai. So it was just family holiday. I haven't had a holiday with my family for a while. So alhamdulillah, it was good, it was nice, it was restful, but there's a lot to do there as well.
Yeah, Dubai is awesome. So.
Yeah, and it's got the best abayas.
True,
every time
true.
We ask someone, where did you get it from? It's like, Dubai, it's like, cool.
Can't go to Dubai right now.
But it also was super expensive. Yeah. Can't forget that detail. Alhamdulillah.
So, well, the topic today is all about halal socialising. Mm-hmm. So I think if you could tell us a bit about halal socialising first, and also what kind of things should we be wary of when we're halal socialising?
Yeah, I think socialising is obviously a very broad topic. There are many kind of aspects of it, especially, you know, living in the West and being a young person, that we can find, you know, are not 100% Islamic compliant. You know, generally, you know, trying not to be in bad environments, whether those, we see lots of young people, you know, these days, they're going to clubs, pubs, you know, shisha cafes, another really, really big one, you know, at the same time when school ends, proms, parties, you know, this is very much the norm for girls your age. These are not always, well, practically never, in accordance with Islam. You've always got some kind of, you know, whether it's drinking or drugs, subhanAllah, at lots of these places as well. Even just free mixing between men and women, young boys, young girls. All of these don't necessarily encourage us to do good, abide by Islam, these kinds of environments. So I think that's definitely something that you need to be wary of when you're socialising and hanging out with your friends.
Many young people feel like Islam restricts them from like socialising and enjoying themselves. Do you have like any recommendations of like how we can do this and where we could go?
I think, okay, there's two important points to make here. The first thing is that, you know, having said that there are all of these things that Islam doesn't necessarily permit us to engage in, Islam is not against fun. Fun is completely halal, you know, but at the same time, in Islam, fun does not just revolve around alcohol or free mixing or any of these kind of things. The second point is that we should always have the attitude that in Islam, everything is allowed. It's a principle within Islam that everything is allowed unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explicitly stated it otherwise. So we don't need to be going through the books of hadith and looking at all of the verses of the Quran trying to find where does it say that shopping is allowed, where does it say going to the park is allowed. You know, all of these things, we're encouraged to spend time with our friends. But at the same time, we need to make sure that we're in a good atmosphere, you know, one that we're not doing any haram and one that doesn't lead us or, you know, encourage us to do something wrong and that, you know, we're taking as much benefit from it as possible. So there's a variety of things that we can do with our friends, spending a lot of time with them, you know, going out to various places and enjoying ourselves, but at the same time making sure that we don't lose focus of our greater purpose in life, which is, you know, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within the midst of that.
Yeah, I think that, you know, lots of people like get it mixed up with, you know, the fact that Islam prohibits certain things means that, you know, fun is banned, fun is haram, but that's obviously, like you said, not the case. Anything can be fun as long as you put like a positive mindset towards it. You can make anything in life fun, you know. And Islam is, alhamdulillah, so beautiful that it's given us guidelines on how to do everything. It's not only told us what to do, but it's told us like ways to do it, and it's given us examples. And obviously, halal socializing is no exception. So what are the manners and etiquettes that we should have when we're socialising?
That's a good question.
I think perhaps one of the biggest things that I'll touch on first when it comes to, you know, socialising, hanging out with our friends is segregation. Because obviously, especially, you know, living in a society that doesn't, you know, recognise segregation or understand that, that's, I think, one of the biggest obstacles that young people have to face. You know, we know as young Muslims that whilst we are allowed and permitted and encouraged in some cases, you know, to work with members of the opposite gender where necessary, you know, whether that's medicine or for education or for, you know, learning Islam, for just general having fun and socialising and chit-chat, this isn't permitted. There's various evidences for this. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, he allocated one door of Masjid al-Nabawi for women, and it was known. He said, you know, this is the door of the masjid that will be for women, you know, just to prevent, you know, even intermingling where it's not necessary, even if you just bump into someone, you know. These aren't things that Islam encourages. And in another occasion, you know, Aisha radiallahu anha narrated that I used to play with my friends, and when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, they would leave, and when they came, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would leave. So again, you know, it's not necessary to be in the same environment where, you know, you're just having fun and playing and chit-chatting. And we know that Aisha radiallahu anha is always lovely to read any of her narrations, because obviously she was a young girl, you know, similar to our ages at the time that she was, you know, living with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it's always good to get her perspective on these things.
But I also think it's really important to find a balance. So like it, like you mentioned, like in a society where it's inevitable for us to, be in a situation where we have to work with people of the opposite gender, I think it's really important for Muslims to learn how to speak to them, or learn how to speak with each other in a respectful manner, in a manner that's not necessarily that's Islamically compliant. Because even though the women did have a separate door in Masjid al-Nabawi, there was also no barrier in the masjid, and the women were able to speak to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were able to see him while he was giving the khutbah. And so I think it's really important that when we have discussions about, you know, free mixing, about you know, dealing with the opposite gender, I think it's really important to find, to make, to ensure that there's a balance, and not to have expectations of people that are just really kind of difficult to reach. So to say to someone that it's haram to speak to guys, or, you know, you can't be I think that's just really
there's
difficult.
There's various scenarios, you know, as said previously, where
we have to and it's necessary to interact with men. But at the same time, segregation is supposed to create an atmosphere within an Islamic society where, you know, you are not constantly encouraged to speak to men. But of course, you know, we are living in a society, especially today, where, you know, men surround us everywhere, and there is nothing in Islam that says that you are not allowed to go and speak to someone, or you're not allowed to go and work with someone where it's necessary. But it's making sure that where it's not necessary, we understand the significance of that and take, you know, actions accordingly. But segregation is just, I think, it's one aspect of, you know, halal socialising. There's many other aspects as well. Another one that I think, you know, often in today's times, just where, you know, the culture is not necessarily this way inclined, is that, you know, Islam doesn't allow swearing or bad language. Even, you know, we should always speak of decent things. We should always be polite to other people. Backbiting, gossiping, these are, you know, huge issues within friendship circles. Being inclusive of everybody. All of these aspects, they form a state of mind which ultimately represents haya. Haya is not just modesty in the way that you dress or looking down or, you know, not shouting loudly. These aspects don't necessarily come into haya. But haya is maintaining a state of mind and, you know, acting according to the regulations that Islam has set down for you with men and with women and, you know, just generally in your daily life. So all of these things need to be considered.
I really like what you said about being inclusive of everyone. I think that's really important. Like, for us as young people, it's very easy for us to create cliques and, like, to just socialise with our people or, you know, just to
to leave other people out.
And it's actually the sunnah of the Prophet to include people, especially those quieter people, those people kind of drift away from everyone else.
Absolutely.
So I think that's a really beautiful quality that us as Muslims should kind of try and take on.
Definitely. I think even generally with halal socialising, I think it may seem like so hard, but I think it's just putting yourself in the right environment. Mm-hmm. You're consciously aware of where you're going, and you should be realising, like, why would you put yourself at that risk if you feel like it might be something that you might feel uncomfortable in, or, you know, there's this but then there's that. If you ever put yourself in that situation, I think you should just take yourself out of it. And it's, again, having some haya as well. So, like, being aware of the environment you're in and also being aware of yourself and your mannerisms. And speaking of mannerisms, of course, the Prophet and the Sahaba, biggest examples, best role models, have ever walked this earth. So what mannerisms and etiquettes did they adopt, and you know, how did they treat others, and how did they socialise?
Very good question. Looking back on this, you see as well, and something that Sarah mentioned earlier, that, you know, the relationship between the Sahaba with Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but amongst themselves as well, it was very strong. You know, it was a friendship, and we're encouraged to maintain friendships in Islam and to surround ourselves, you know, with good company, because you will benefit from them as they can benefit from you. We can see that the Sahaba, they were always very polite, inclusive, you know, as we've just been saying, you know, they included people who, as Sarah just said, you know, perhaps a bit more quiet, didn't necessarily like to put themselves out there, but it's considered, you know, we know, rude in Islam to just exclude somebody just because they're not saying something. If there's three people there and two of them are speaking in a different language, you know, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam specifically said, you know, you shouldn't do that because the third person doesn't know what you're saying. We can even see from Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's mannerisms, whenever he was speaking to someone, he turned to face them completely, his whole face, his whole body. Nowadays, we're all just like looking at our phones, someone takes something, we're like, yeah. You know, again, these are just little things in our personalities that obviously people from the past, they didn't have. I think another big thing that often you see in sort of friendship groups today is that their idea of banter or joking is often just like kind of veiled insults. And, you know, sometimes with your friends, it's okay to joke around and, you know, say some funny things that somebody else does, but this can very quickly lead into sort of something a bit more serious, you know, whether it's bullying or just making that person feel, you know, a bit upset. You don't know necessarily what they're feeling insecure about. I think another thing to mention is that whenever the Sahaba used to get together, something that they would always try and incorporate into that gathering was the mention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, he specifically said, no people sit in an assembly without mentioning Allah and without asking for Allah's blessings on the Prophet, peace be upon him, except that it will be a cause of sorrow upon them. Basically, that, you know, they're not reaping any reward from that. So in the akhirah, they will be a bit like, oh, if we just said something, you know, we could have, inshallah, got more hasanat for that. So I think looking at all of these things and trying to incorporate them, there are only very little things, into what we do with our friends, they can be, inshallah, a source of great reward for us.
Yeah, I think the way, you know, you act around your friends, especially, is like a big thing, because you know, they're your friends, so obviously you're not as careful as what you'd say to them as, you know, other people, maybe adults or strangers or something. But then you do sometimes forget, or you can sometimes forget that, you know, they're human, they've got feelings too, and you, again, you don't know what's going on in their mind. You don't know if you might upset them by saying this. And I think also the inclusion is really important, because just because somebody, you may think they want to be left alone, doesn't necessarily mean they do want to be left alone. It might just be that they're not confident enough to be able to come forward. You know, there might be something going on. They just want to, maybe they want to talk to someone about it, but they don't know how to approach them. And, you know, that's a big issue. It does happen in day-to-day life. And, you know, for me, socialising is, like, always on top of my agenda. You know, I never like to be doing nothing. I always like to be keeping busy. So, you know, I'm always at school talking to my friends. Obviously, I'm studying, but I am talking to my friends and then when I get home, I'll talk to them on the phone or something. And then every weekend, I'm spending time with my family. So a lot of my time is taken up by socialising, but I do think it's also really important to have that, you know, part of your life where you do just spend time worshipping Allah, and, you know, also furthering your knowledge about Islam, learning more, because we're not perfect and we can always increase our knowledge about Islam. Mm-hmm. So how do we manage our time balancing ibadah and socialising?
Yeah, no, it's a very good question, especially you guys also when you get to university. There's actually very little work. A lot of it is just socialising, and people say you go to university for the atmosphere, and oh my gosh, the amount of time that you spend just seeing people just sitting around, it can get to be a waste. But so, yep, it's a very good question, and especially when balancing it with ibadah, which is obviously something, you know, of utmost importance to all of us, it's something that needs to be considered. So all of our actions as Muslims, they fall into sort of, you know, can say various categories. Of the halal, you know, there's things that we do that are fard, that we have to do, so salah, fasting, you know, being respectful to our parents, you know, all of these kind of activities that, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed for us in the Qur'an. Then there's actions that are mandub, so those that were encouraged, the sunnah things that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, said were beneficial for us, that we can gain extra reward from. Then there's actions that are nafila, so extra things that weren't necessarily, you know, specifically said, but or you know, encouraged deliberately, but like, you know, dhikr. It's nafila. You're not going to get any punishment if you don't do it, but, you know, if you do it, you'll get, inshallah, extra reward. This will all come together, I promise. Then there's actions that are mubah. And this is, I think, where socialising the category it comes into. Actions that you don't get reward for, you don't get sin for, but, you know, it's permitted for you to do. So socialising and these kinds of activities, hanging out with our friends, whether it's going to the cinema, shopping, any of these things, they fall into those things where, you know, it's not haram, but at the same time, you don't necessarily get reward for it. At the same time, mubah actions are not something that we should excess in, because obviously it becomes a waste of time. If it prevents you, or you forget, you know, if you're hanging out with your friends and you forget to do your salah, which is a fard, then that immediately becomes, you know, not something good for you, because you've forgotten to do something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed for you. When it comes to balancing it, I always think about it, it's useful to kind of think about it in the context of, you know, as much time as you're spending on mubah actions, try and make up to an equal or, you know, a significant amount of time also doing sunnah actions, mandub ones that are encouraged, or nafil actions, just extra actions. If you're going to see your friends, make dhikr on the tube while you're going there, inshallah, it'll be beneficial. And as we said before, you know, mentioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with your friends, talking about useful things, you know, making it a source of knowledge for you, inshallah, is an opportunity to get reward from that as well. So I think it's always about looking for the opportunities for reward.
It's so easy, and I think I have mentioned this before, but, you know, it just proves that Allah loves us. The fact that He's making Islam, He's making gaining good deeds so easy for us, you know, that we can just get on with our day-to-day lives, do what we do every day, but be gaining tons of reward for it. For what? Just for, you know, doing what we do.
I think, like, a really big problem is that a lot of young Muslim girls, they feel peer pressured into doing things that we're not allowed to do. So how can we, like, remind ourselves of our higher purpose and, like, keep away from these things?
It's a very sort of question. It's almost a whole topic in itself, you know, peer pressure and friends and things like that. Obviously, I think, you know, another principle within Islam is prevention is better than cure. So you should always try and surround yourself with good company such that, inshallah, you won't feel peer pressured into doing something that's not 100%, you know, within Islamic guidelines. We know the hadith as well where Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, he compared good friends to that of a perfume shop where you come out, you know, smelling beautiful with them, and bad friends to a blacksmith's shop where you come out, you know, smelling of smoke and you've got, like, dust on you. So that just shows the impact, I think, that friends can have upon us. So keeping good company, I think, is the first thing. Second thing, I think, is to always remember that, you know, this life is temporary. Ultimately, what is our purpose in life is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As much fun as we're having doing something, we know that the real joy is in the akhirah. Sometimes we have to sacrifice some things that, you know, we know aren't in accordance with Islam. Mm. That's always for a greater purpose, you know, and ultimately this is something that's good for us. Allah's only prevents what's bad for us. Mm. So I think remembering that and keeping that in mind, and also, you know, having the sorts of friends that would encourage you to perhaps do things that aren't from Islam, it's not worth having them then if they were to encourage you to do that, because no one is worth sacrificing your akhirah for. But at the same time, try and influence your friends then to do good things. I'm not just saying, you know, just cut everybody bad off in your life. Islam doesn't have that attitude. It's about, you know, helping other people and helping yourself, you know, educating yourself, getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and making dua, you know, that Allah helps you in whichever situations you find yourself, and that you can influence other people for good as well.
Fantastic. So what I was going to ask, and inshallah this kind of leads off to Anisha's question, there are cases where, you know, you haven't necessarily done the thing, you haven't gone and you've decided not to do it, you've decided not to engage into the activity that you, that is fun but not necessarily correct. What about for someone who is already engaging in it, someone who's already in a habit of engaging in it? They know it's wrong, they don't want to do it, but it's something that they do regularly, consistently, periodically. What advice would you give to that person?
Variety of things. I think obviously the first thing when confronted with any problem that we should do is just make dua. You know, some of these things, it's very difficult. Sometimes when you feel like, you know, you're not doing necessarily the right thing, but you're just stuck, you don't know where to go to, ultimately turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah is greater than every single problem, and thus He is the ultimate solution. So by calling upon Him, making your situation easier, you know, if you don't have the strength to do it, asking Him for the strength to do it and find you a way out, that is the first thing that I would say definitely do. Second thing is perhaps, you know, educate yourself a little bit more. You'd be more, you're more inclined to give something up when you realise sort of the harms that it causes, you know. If you find out that some chocolate or something is really unhealthy for you, if you look at all of the statistics of how much fat it has, all the calories in it, then you're more like, okay, yeah, fine, I'm not going to have it. So read up a little bit on why does Islam say that this isn't the ideal situation to be in? What potential harms can come out of this? And inshallah, that will help you dissociate yourself from it more. And again, I think just try and perhaps, you know, if you're your friendship group aren't going to change and they're not going to help you go down this path, try and find new friends. And again, that comes into, you know, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to provide you with good people. And I've seen it happen, you know, definitely. Allah, He does answer your du'as. And if He doesn't, then that's because He's got something better in store for you. So never ever lose hope. And I think those would be my top three things.
One of the main things that comes to my mind personally when I think about this question and when I think about people who are in these situations is how alcohol became haram in Islam. Because it was something that it was a social activity. Drinking was a big deal amongst the Arabs in the time, including the Sahaba, believe it or not. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't just send one verse and say, all right, it's done, you're not allowed to drink anymore. It was a process. So first, you know, verses about how there's more harms and benefits came down, and then verses about you know, ensuring that you're sober when it comes to salah. And finally, verses saying that, you know, alcohol is done. It's not part of the religion, it's something that you need to give up. And of course Prophet said that, you know, the streets of Medina were filled with alcohol because people were so willing to give it up. So just from this, kind of to recognise that it's a process and it's something that the Sahaba went through. It's something that, you know, there is a corresponding message and lesson that you can find from the life of the Prophet and his companions. But Jazakallah khair, sisters. Great discussion, alhamdulillah, very beneficial. So there you have it. Halal fun is a thing. Coming to the understanding that the default of social activities are halal or lawful unless explicitly mentioned otherwise, there's a variety of things that we can do to enjoy ourselves. Allah doesn't seek to prevent us from anything that we enjoy, except that the physical, emotional, or even social harms outweigh any benefits. We're off to a break now, but we'd love to know your thoughts on our discussion, so do tweet us at Islam Channel, hashtag StepUp. See you in three. To smell, to touch, to hear. We rely on our senses so much that we can't really imagine life without them. But this is the reality for millions of people around the world who are visually impaired or blind. This means that simple tasks that we take for granted, whether it's walking down the stairs or making a meal, become so much more difficult and even dangerous for these people.
In the UK, almost 2 million people are living with sight loss. By 2050, this number will have doubled. Amongst this uncertainty and fear, one special animal can offer hope and guidance. These are Guide Dogs.
Victoria, it is lovely meeting you. So how common is it for someone to go blind? And does a person have to be fully blind to have a guide dog?
Well, actually, every hour someone in the UK goes blind, and there's actually 2 million people in the UK living with sight loss. I think my love of dogs drew me to the organisation initially, and also, you know, I really want to do something rewarding, something to get up every day, and guide dogs just kind of ticks all the boxes there. You know, you get to work with such amazing dogs, and you know that you're going to change someone's life, so that's really quite special to be part of that. We carry out a lot of obedience exercises. We want the dogs to be nice and responsive to the handler, as this is important. And we want the dogs to accept wearing the harness, which you can see Fawn's wearing now. We teach our dogs to walk out in a guiding position, giving tension on the handle so a guide dog owner will be able to follow the movement. And we teach our dogs to all stop at curb edges, either a sit or a stand. We want them to avoid any obstacles in their path, display caution, and to follow what we call a straight line principle. And this is for orientation for a guide dog owner. And we teach our dogs left and right commands so they know which way to go. There's a few stages to their training. So Four is in early training, which is about 16 weeks. And that's where they learn all their guiding tasks, introduce the equipment. And then after that, they go on to advanced training. And that's an additional 10 to 12 weeks. That's where it gets a little bit more challenging. A lot more responsibility is given to the dog. And also during that time, they're then matched to their new potential guide dog owner.
Wait, good boy.
I think one of our youngest clients was a young boy, so between 11 and teenager, and we have guide dog owners in their 70s, 80s and 90s working. It's actually £50,000, and that's taken a dog from birth all the way up to retirement, so it's a really big cost, and guide dogs isn't government funded at all, so we really rely on the support from the general public and donations to help support what we do.
Okay, so what I'm going to show you now is just some basic obedience that we do. Obedience is really important because it's all utilised for their guiding tasks. We want the dogs to be nice and responsive. So first of all, I'm just going to show you what we call a stand response. So I'll just walk him round and show you. Four, heel, heel, lovely, heel, heel, stand. Good, so the dog will stop standing, and you want him to be nice and straight and relaxed, and the dog should remain in that position until the handler tells. We teach the stand response for when they're in harness. If they come across something like a narrow gap where they are not able to fit through without avoiding a collision, then the dog will indicate by stopping and standing, so that's really important. Another one is a sit. Good boy. Again, you want the dog to be nice and responsive to the command. This is really important. We use this for curbs, for stopping. Wait. Again, you want the dog to wait. If the handler has to move off for any reason, you want the dog to stay there until the handler comes back or gives the dog a command. So as you can see, he's nice and relaxed. He's looking at me all the time, which is a good boy, and he gets praise for that. Well done. And then I'm going to show you a down. Down. Good boy. This is for if the dog's travelling on transport, so you want them to settle. It's also used if you're in a bit of a social situation, so if you're in a cafe or if you're in the office, you want the dog to lie down next to your feet, and then you want the dog to stay there nice and relaxed. He's not fidgeting, he's not moving around, and he should just wait there regardless now of what I do. Woo! He should stay there and be a good boy until I ask him to either heel, which is the direction to follow me. Heel, good boy. Well done. And then he gets a big cuddle. Yay! Well done. Good boy. Yeah, we want our dogs to enjoy it. It's supposed to be a big game to them, really. Otherwise, there's no point doing it. And I think he's had a good time. Straight. Good boy. Straight on. So it's nice and steady when he's crossing. Straight on. And then I'm going to ask him, find left. Good boy.
This is our obstacle course. So this is what we use to teach our dogs how to avoid obstacles and negotiate around them safely. So what you're going to have a fantastic opportunity and have a little feel of what it's like for someone with sight loss and what it feels like to follow a guide dog. So I'm going to give you this. Mm-hmm. This is a mindfold. It's blocks out any light, so it gives you a complete sense of what it's like to have absolutely no vision at all. It can be a little bit disorientating, and it just makes you realise how much you rely on that sense. So I'm going to talk you through the process. Four's going to be guiding you through, and I'm going to be supporting as he's still learning, he's still in training, and he's going to negotiate you round the obstacles, giving you plenty of clearance so you're not going to bump into any, and it will give you a sense of what it's like to put your trust in the dog and following the handle as he takes you through. Okay, so if you're ready, you can pop that on. So I'm just going to ask you to pick up the handle with your left arm, hold it very nice and relaxed in your fingertips, keep your arm straight, and you want to keep it parallel to your left leg and Four's back legs, and you're going to follow him and keep that nice tension on the hand on his movements. I'm going to be up at front guiding him, so I just want you to relax, enjoy the ride, and just concentrate on following that handle. Okay?
Yeah.
All right, you ready?
Yeah.
Four. Forward. Good boy. If you want, you can take your blindfold off now.
Oh, it's still like.
Yeah, and everything's going to be really bright, I'm sure. And how was that?
That was actually really good. Like, I could put my whole trust into him. Like, he took me everywhere, but yeah.
It's very unnatural. You know, you've got to follow this handle. And I know a couple of times you probably think, oh, is there something there? And it's really hard to kind of go, no, it's okay. I trust Four and I'm going to follow him.
That was a fascinating insight on how guide dogs are trained and how the charity works. Now we have with us Lucy Morris, who is a guide dog owner, and she will be telling us about how her life has changed after she had Bruce, her guide dog. Hi Lucy. So I just wanted to start off with, how has Bruce helped you?
He helps me just do everything really in life. I go to the shops with him, I'm able to go to work, go and visit friends all over the place, just do my own thing without having to rely on other people at all.
And so how long did it take for you to get trained to use Bruce, and what kind of activities did you do?
So it starts with a phone call. The guide dog trainers phone you up saying, we've got a dog that might be a suitable match for you. Then they come and meet you in your home, you do a practice walk with you and the dog. And then you say as to whether or not you feel comfortable with the dog, and then the trainer will see if you're comfortable with the dog. And then after that, you will go to a hotel for about 2 weeks where you get given the dog on the second day. You go around the hotel and you do little obedience bits with the dog, building up the trust with the dog. And after that, you start to go to residential routes and then busier routes where there's a lot of traffic, walking with the dog, getting used to how the dog works and how you feel comfortable working. And then after 2 weeks, you go back to your home, you take the dog with you. Then the trainer will come to your house and do some routes that you will do regularly. So whether or not to the post box, to the post office, to the shops, to the local supermarket, bus routes, train routes that you might do. And then you do your qualifying walk where your trainer will come and watch you do the walk. And from then onwards, you can go about independently with your dog.
And what would you say to those who are watching? How can they help in funding the project for guide dogs?
I think there are loads of different ways to help guide dogs. if you see somebody with a guide dog, just asking them if they're okay. Maybe not if they're walking, if they're stood somewhere looking like they're a little bit lost, just asking if they need any help, or just contacting their local guide dogs branch and seeing if they need any help at all. Looking on their website, there's plenty of ways that you can get involved with guide dogs on their website.
Thank you so much for talking to us today, and all the best with Bruce. Guide dogs play an important role in so many people's lives. We must thank Allah for putting such intelligent animals on this planet. We are indebted to our senses, and for those who aren't as blessed, we must help and support them in the best way we can. Why not visit your local guide dogs training centre and see how you can help?
Abu Ubaidah was born to the Qurayshi clan of Banu al-Hirath ibn Fihr. His father was very strict. He had trained Abu Ubaidah to be strong and skillful from when he was just a child. He was only in his teenage years when he accepted Islam. When Abu Ubaidah's father heard about him converting to Islam, of course he was furious and persecuted him to such an extent that Abu Ubaidah emigrated to Abyssinia with a small band of other Muslims. After the establishment of Islam in Medina, Abu Ubaidah joined them and lived in a house of another famous Sahabi, Mu'adh ibn Jabal. He joined Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in many battles using his military skill in defending the Prophet of Allah. Abu Ubaidah's devotion to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was again shown at the Battle of Uhud. When the battle was over, it was found that the Prophet's forehead was bashed in with two discs from his shield, had penetrated into his cheeks. Abu Bakr went forward with the intention of extracting these discs, but Abu Ubaidah said, "Please, leave that to me." Abu Ubaidah was afraid that he would cause the Prophet pain if he took out the discs with his hands, so instead, he bit hard into one of the discs. It was extracted, but one of his own incisor teeth fell to the ground in the process. With his other incisor, he extracted the other disc, but lost that tooth too. What a man. And yet, Abu Ubaidah was also known to be a very simple man who didn't want any materialistic possessions. Once, during the Khalifa of Umar ibn al-Khattab, Umar radiallahu anhu surprised Abu Ubaidah with a visit to his house. Umar radiallahu anhu asked Abu Ubaidah in the shock where his furniture was and why he had none, even though he was a commander amongst the Muslims. Abu Ubaidah replied, "I have no need for this. I told you, you would hurt your eyes over me." Umar ibn al-Khattab, overwhelmed by the piety of his brother, started to cry. Abu Ubaidah devoted his life to carrying his deen in every aspect of his life. His love of the akhirah and his humble lifestyle are an example for us all to follow. A truly inspirational individual and someone we can all learn so much from, mashallah.
Exactly, and I only hope that I can implement half of the good qualities he exhibited.
Yeah, me too. Today we speak to Mona Ali, a photographer. Let's find out more.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Muna Ali. I'm a photographer. So I always photographed. I always used to carry a camera around me wherever I went. Professionally, I've been photographing for 2 years now. When I first started, right after I graduated university, I didn't even know how to use the camera. I started from the very basic of learning how to handle a DSLR camera, and I did that by renting out a camera from my university's loan store, and then borrowing my friend's camera and just practicing with it until eventually I managed to do a few jobs and buy my own camera. I have a creative background. I graduated in surface design and I've always been very, very creative within kind of my entire school years. I love expressing myself. I love finding new ways to put out my ideas and my inspirations. Having no experience with a DSLR, I first had to learn how to use it, which was obviously a challenge in its own right. I had to kind of chase the knowledge, which was exciting, and I think that's part of the reason why I wanted to pursue it in the first place, was to take on that challenge, that self-initiated project, and to have a really good outcome out of it. So that was probably one of the hardest challenges, just to actually technically learn. The second challenge was probably trying to convince my parents that this was a right career for me to take. And of course, there are a lot of people out there who don't believe in the arts as a valid pathway to follow. A lot of people think that art should be a hobby and not something that you pursue as a full-time career. And I always kind of have to challenge them with the idea that actually art can be a job and a creative outlet is a proper job. And if anything, first of all, I had to understand that myself before I can even try to explain it to anybody else. I completely disagree that Islam and creativity don't go together. I always draw upon the verse which says that Allah is beautiful and He loves beauty. And I always, as a creative, I try to reflect on that and try to almost encapsulate that ayah within the creativity that I output. So yeah, Islam is beautiful. Beauty around us is evident, right? And Quran often talks about Allah's creation and it talks about just the bounties around us. And I think as creatives, we're gifted with the ability to actually see this and be able to capture it and be able to share it out with other people who may not have the same perspective as we do. Within my arts practice, I went to University of the Arts London. I started off at London College of Fashion. So I did an arts and design foundation, which was fashion based. And we needed to do portraits, but specifically life drawing, which of course we know that using Islam's principles honesty, life drawing is just not acceptable. So therefore I had to excuse myself from that particular subject. It was perfectly okay and it didn't hinder my marks in any ways. So I think sometimes, you know, you do get scared and you feel that, okay, perhaps if I don't take part in something, it's going to completely affect my education or my marks. But a lot of the times I feel if you do communicate and express yourself about your religious beliefs, people are actually very, very accepting and there are always alternatives of things to do. Photography has led me on such amazing trips. I managed to travel. I traveled out to the Middle East and to Africa. And during my time there, I got to work with a charity. And with that charity, I was their ambassador. We were going out looking at the different projects that they were doing. I was able to photograph and document these projects, which then I started putting up on Instagram and Facebook and actually letting people know about them. And actually, consequently, a lot of people actually started taking interest in the projects by the charities and donating and actually being aware of the causes that the charity were fundraising for. So in that way, it definitely opened my eyes as to what photography can do. It opened my eyes to the ability of visually impacting people. I had so much fun. I totally embraced my art, I embraced my creativity, and at the end of it, the impact of it was very beautiful and it was still very Islamically acceptable. I didn't have to compromise on anything and I didn't have to break down any kind of like boundaries that are set upon me. You know, if anything, it was such a beautiful combination of both Islam and creativity at the same time. Thank you. The future is inspiring for me right now. It's looking so exciting. After my travel project, all I want to do is travel out more. I want to meet more cultures. I want to meet more people. I want to document more stories. I want to connect more. And I definitely want to continue using photography as a vehicle of raising awareness for causes, and to definitely bring communities together and to get people aware of things that they possibly have never seen before. Keeping as passionate as ever. And I think that with any young person who's looking out to what they want to do in the future, take it all on. Take anything and everything that comes your way. Reach out to any opportunity that you can. Do those volunteer experiences. Travel if you can. Talk to people. Connect with people. And you'll find that your life is so much more enriched, and you'll truly find what your soul's calling is.
So much creativity there, mashallah.
I think it's so clever how photography is so dependent on good lighting and image composition. It's how they see everything so differently from the average eye, I guess.
It's amazing. Really great work, mashallah. Well, that's it for this episode, but please do email us with your comments and feedback on stepup@islamchannel.tv. Next week, we discuss the Quran in our lives. The Quran was brought down by Angel Jibreel and passed on to us by the beloved Prophet as a criterion and guide for life, but has it impacted our lives in the way it should?
And we look at a sister with a very successful hamper business, Mubarak London.
For that and more, catch us again, same time, same place, next week.
And until then, Assalamu alaikum from the team.
Assalamu alaikum.
We actually looked at each other this time.
Yeah, it's great.
So do get entering.
Don't worry about entering just yet.
Were we supposed to talk?
I don't know. Oh yeah. I just looked at you.
I was like, I'm nasty, you're doing this. I was like, what? No, I'm not.
No, oh no, don't even think about bloopers. This whole show is a blooper.